Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Please.
So today we are discussing Shish Upanishad. We are still on introduction.
今天来讲这个至尊奥义书，还是这最开始的导言，就看看我们能讲多少。
With a little correction, it is part of the Yajurveda.
属于这个在四部委托里面的亚俱委托经里面。
And it's directly within the text itself. It's not a separate text.
这个呢，至尊奥义书已经属于在亚俱委托书经典里面，不是说额外分开的。
This is why all the scholars and all the acharyas and all the devotees consider the Shish Upanishad to be very important scripture.
那这是为什么呢？很多的学者啦，或者是说 acharya 都认为至尊奥义书是那么重要。
So last time we also discussed the approach towards the Upanishad, trying to understand what the Vedic scriptures are. Prabhupada is explaining what the Vedic scriptures are.
那上一回我们提到的 Prabhupada 再解释一下说委托经典到底是哪一些内容。
And the way how to approach the Vedic scriptures, the whole process.
然后就是说怎么样去走向这个接近这个委托经典的程序。
So that we have proper understanding what the Vedic scripture is, and then how to approach it, then we get proper result.
所以这样我们就知道，也可以了解什么是委托经典，然后怎么样是正确的研读经典的方式，才有得到就是说正当应该得到的结果。
This is how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught us how to understand everything.
那这是主持人Mahaprabhu所教导我们，就是说怎么样来了解一切。
Namely, the process of Sambandha Abhideya Prayojana.
最主要的程序就是Sambandha Abhideya Prayojana。
Understand the nature of something, understand the feel of something.
了解事物的本身，还有这个了解事物的范围。
Then what is the knowledge, understanding of that thing?
然后对于这一个事物的知识。
Which means how to perform action, therefore, so that's Abhideya.
所以就是说，知道怎么样去行动，就是这样去跟他的关系 Abhideya.
So then, knowing that, then we can expect certain kind of result.
所以知道这样的话，我们就可以去期待、期望，就是说应该要有的怎么样的结果。
So this is what Srila Prabhupada is stressing and discussed at last, and so we're going to continue.
所以这是 Prabhupada 上次所说的，也是我们讨论，我们将继续。
So we can read from the page number 5. There is a spiritual scribe.
Yes.
Yeah, so the paragraph. It's a little larger. It's quite large.
to read it.
Yeah.
整个宇宙中有一个灵性天空，远在展示和不展示的自然之外，有另外一个自然。但你们怎么知道有一个天空？其中的众多星球和上面的居民都是永恒的呢？所有这些知识都有记载，可是你们是怎么进行实验的？那是不可能的，因此你们必须借助于韦达经，这称为韦达知识。我们 Krishna 意识运动中的成员，从最权威的人物 Krishna 那里接受知识。Krishna 被所有阶层的人公认为最高的权威。我首先谈两类超然主义者，一类超然主义者被称为非人格神主义者，假象中人士 Mayavadi， 他们通常被称为 Vedantist， 以 Shankaracharya 为首。另外有一类超然主义者被称为 Vaishnava， 是 Ramanujacharya、 Madhvacharya 和 Vishnuswami 等，都是 Shankara 的传承和 Vaishnava 传承，都是公认 Krishna 是至尊人格首神。 Shankaracharya 被认为是传播神、不具人格神特征的 Brahman 的非人格神主义者，但事实上他是一个隐藏自己真实身份的人格神主义者。他在对伯杰梵歌评注时写道，至尊人格首神 Narayana 超越这个宇宙展示。接着他再次确认说，那位至尊人格首神 Narayan 就是 Krishna。 他以 Devaki 和 Vasudeva 之子的身份到来。 Shankaracharya 具体谈到了他父亲和母亲的名字，因此所有的超然主义者都公认 Krishna 是至尊人格首神，这一点是毫无疑问的。我们有关 Krishna 意识的知识源头是伯切梵歌，直接由 Krishna 讲述。我们接受了 Krishna 说的原话，不加自己的解释，为此出版了伯切梵歌原译，那是 Veda 知识。既然 Veda 知识是纯净的，我们接受它，无论 Krishna 说什么我们都接受，这就是 Krishna 意识。这样做节省我们很多时间。你们如果接受正确的权威知识的源头，就会节省许多时间。例如宇宙世界里有两种获得知识的方法，归纳法和推理法。用归纳法，你们认识到人是会死的，你们的父亲说人是会死的，你的姐姐说人是会死的，大家都说人是会死的，你们并没有去做实验，而是接受人是会死的是个事实。你们若想探究出人是否会死，就得去研究每一个人。你们也许会想，或许有人不死，但你们还没有看到他的，所以如果以这种方式探究，你们永远都探究不完。梵文称为这种程序是由下而上 Aroha 的程序。如果你想要靠个人的努力，靠运用不完美的感官获取知识，那你们将永远都得不到正确的结论，那是不可能的。
So Prabhupada here in this excerpt is discussing what we have just read. He's discussing the very important principle about accepting the authority.
Prabhupada 在这里讲了一个很重要的一个原则，就是要接受权威上司。
Because without enough authority, we cannot understand anything beyond our sense perception.
因为如果没有一个权威上师的话呢，我们是无法去了解超越我们感官可以察觉的事物了。
How can we understand anything about spiritual sky?
那我们是怎么可以能够了解这个灵性宇宙、灵性天空？
You know, even within this universe, how is it possible to understand anything beyond our plan?
即使说在这个宇宙里面，我们怎么有可能了解就是在这个宇宙里面的一切？
Of course, we may try to speculate.
当然我们也许想要去用推敲臆测。
But Srila Prabhupada points out that such a conclusion, speculative conclusion, so to say, it sounds like an oxymoron. How can something be conclusive which is speculative?
It's something like
oxymoron.That's two words that don't come together, like hot eyes and stuff like that.
就是说，如果说用臆 我们自己的推敲臆测的话呢，那就这样是说，事实跟我们推敲的情况是不相容的，就是说你火跟冰是不可能说同时存在的。
In essence, we cannot come to any kind of conclusion.
这个意思就是说没有办法得到结论，如果用推敲就没有办法得到结论。
Because it is imperfect perception.
因为那是不完整的这种察，那就是察知。
Therefore, we, it is just a common sense that we try to accept the authority.
所以呢，这是接受权威是一个通常事。
And of course.Nowadays, nobody wants to have an authority.
但是这个现象在现代呢，就是说人们不想要有权威上司。
Everybody wants to be authority himself.
每个人都想自己来当权威。
It's very difficult to accept anybody else as an authority.
所以那种状态就是说很难去接受别人当做权威了。
Just like we see when we examine any field within material.Material kind of science or interactions, relationships, or within anything.
那就像我们来看的物质世界的任何的关系哈，不管是科学啊，或者生物之间的关系。
Even if somebody to some extent accepts some kind of,
即使说有人可能会去接受某一个权威或某一种的权威。
Later on, when they find various flaws within that kind of teaching, they will reject the very authority itself.But they find some flaws.
Okay.
Something
yeah, sure. 如果说人们去接受了某一类某一个权威，觉得他如果有瑕疵的时候，他们就会变得一种完全拒绝的态度。
It's like something like the Mayavadi approach.
那这种就是 Mayavadi 的这种走向。
Like they will help Srila Prabhupada once. It was interesting. He was walking through the fields of Mayapur, rice fields.
有一次就像呢 Prabhupada 在这个马耶普的这个稻田之间在走的时候。
And you know, there are those trenches, little channels, you know, where water flows, and then the little elevated portions where you can go to the fields.
所以 Prabhupada 就走在那个田野的田间小道哈。
So then Prabhupada was walking with the devotees, and then there was one little, you know, channel with a little water there.
所以呢，田间小道，泼花也是跟奉献者一起走。当然呢，就是那个田需要一个水道，就是引水来灌溉。那刚好那边有一条水道有水。
So one devotee went across in order to reach to Prabhupada to help him.
那因为要跨过这个小水沟哈，小水道，那一个奉献者先往前走一步，然后就这样伸着手要牵着泼花来这样过这个水道。
So then the devotee extended the hand, Prabhupada for the hand, and the devotee pulled, helped Prabhupada pull him on this side.
所以呢，这个奉献者就伸出手，那这个Prabhupada就接着他的手，然后把他这样拉过来哈。
And as that, you know, as Prabhupada was still holding the hand of the devotee.
那当时Prabhupada还抓着这个奉献者的手。
That suddenly and almost violently just kind of shook the side.
那突然间呢，就是抛花抓着他的手，突然间就把这个人手放下哈。那个奉献者就突然间震惊，就说发生什么事，怎么了
？Prabhupada, you know, kind of rejected me in a sense. What did I do? Why did they make any offense?
那个人就说抛花，你为什么突然间这样拒绝我？我做错了什么
？And then Prabhupada raised his hand and he said.
抛花就这样举起他那个，就这样说了。
This is what Mayavadi is doing.
帕帕帕说这是假象中的人这么做的。
Prabhupada acting as a Mayavadi.
所以帕帕帕那时候就展示这个 Mayavadi 人士的行为方法。
So he pointed out they take the help of the guru and then later on they reject him.
所以他们呢就是说先接受 guru 的帮助，那到手了就把 guru 拒绝放掉。
So it's like that in the material world. People just really.They just use authority, so to say, for their own sake.
所以就是这样子，物质世界的人们呢，就利用权威，利用上面的力量，然后得到自己的要的，然后再去拒，然后到了就拒绝。
Already thinking that they're actually the topmost authority.
所以其实他们心里偷偷的想说，只有自己才是最高的权威。
As we know, with science, it happens so often. So many examples. Somebody learns from somebody just later on to completely discarded their theory that they want.
所以呢，这在科学，所谓现今科学里面常常发生，就是说他们做了一些以前的理论，这样继续延伸去做研究，等到他们发现新的发现，发现前面的有瑕疵的时候，他们就前面的理论、前面的权威推翻了。
Of course, that might be from the valid reasons as well, because all of the theories are still theories.
当然了，这可能也有很多原因，因为这些在做实验的很多都是只是假设、学说而已，就是理论。所以那些理论被推翻了，因为都不完整，所以很容易被推翻。
Like in the field of psychology, for example, modern psychology.
就好像在现代心理学一样，也有。
Sigmund Freud, yeah.
弗洛伊德哈。
He was very so-called famous psychologist and psychoanalysis.
弗洛伊德是很有名的精神分析家。
But of course, all of his theories have been proven wrong.
当然了，后来他的所有的理论呢，都被证明是错的。
And his two of the best of the disciples have rejected his theories.
那他所谓最他的两个高徒后来呢也把他推倒，就是拒绝他的。当然，他这两个门徒是所有好的 理由去拒绝。
One of them was Erich Fromm, and another one was Carl Jung.
一个是卡扬，还有一个是荣格。
And sure, Srila Prabhupada complimented you for having a pretty good idea about the soul.
那波潘对。对于荣格所说呢，对他所以荣格有这种灵魂的概念，包括有好的评语。
So in essence, it is very difficult to first of all find the right authority, and then later on having mentality to acknowledge it.
所以呢，这个是一个情况呢，就是很难找到一个好的、真正的权威上师，然后呢，后面呢还得继续说去实践他的。
And then, of course, to accept it.
当然了，就是要了解权威，然后你又要去接受这个权威的。
Because to the extent we accept the authority, to the extent we can understand that we can advance, especially in the spiritual.
所以，当我们接受权威的时候，我们可以了解，我们可以在灵性上进步。
Because there is no question of being without any kind of authority; it's just impossible in this world.
在这个世界做任何事情呢，是如果没有任何权威，是绝对不可能的。
Very often, young people may be very enthusiastic to have, not to have any kind of authority.
那就是常常发生的，就是年轻人呢，他们不喜欢有人管，不喜欢有权威上司。
But you know, this is just imagination.
他们这种想法只是一种想象而已。
But sooner or later, everybody finds himself learning at least something from somebody else.
因为不管怎么样，早晚呢，每一个人呢，就算这些年轻人他拒绝了那些前面的人，可是他要学东西，还是必须他会去找某一些人去学。
So we know from the Vedic point of view, the acceptance of authority is the most essential.
所以从伟达的经典来看呢，接受权威是最重要的。
Because through developing proper relationships, we can receive proper knowledge.
因为要建立正确的关系，才能去得到这个正确的知识。
So developing a good character and cultivating the proper values.
所以要培养好的品德，然后有良好的生活价值观念。
And therefore also developing good attitude, proper attitude, then the proper knowledge can be imparted.
然后也要培养正确的态度，这样呢，正确的知识呢才能被传授出来。
Because otherwise we will have as an authority our own mind and our own senses.
不然的话呢，我们的权威上司就是我们自己的心意，我们自己的感官当我们的权威。
And that in no way can lead us to any kind of spiritual realization.
那这样就没有办法让我们引向的任何的灵性的领悟。
So also in such kind of a common understanding of anything that is beyond our senses and the mind.
所以在这样子呢，超越我们感官啊，我们心里的这一些了解跟察知。
So Prabhupada points out that we just have to accept the authority of the scriptures.
那Prabhupada就指出，我们就是应该接受经典的权威。
Because we don't know anything about the spiritual world.
因为我们对灵性世界都不了解，不知道。
Therefore, we have to accept this information from the bona fide source.
因此，我们必须要从这正确的源头去寻得知识。
And who is the ultimate authority?
谁是说终极的权威？
Therefore, Srila Prabhupada points out here that it is Krishna.
那 Prabhupada 在这里指出呢，终极权威就是 Krishna.
Param Dhamma, Param Dhamma.Paritam Purusham Divyam Adideva Majambhidim Shashvatam Purusham Arjuna is saying that actually you are the topmost, you are the supreme, you are the absolute.
Arjuna 就说了主啊你是至尊的你是最高的绝对真理
So this is who Krishna is, he is the absolute authority for everything.
这就是什么呢 Krishna 是所有一切的至尊权威
Because he is the source of everything.
因为它是一切的源头。
So also in the same verse, Arjuna is pointing out, you know, Asito Devalo Vyasa. This is in the 10th chapter. He's pointing out there are so many other acharyas, Asito Devalo Vyasa. They also confirm that you are the supreme personality.
那 Krishna 呢，在第十章《菩提梵歌》第十章里面说了呢，啊，就是说 Arjuna 这样子对 Krishna 说呢，就说有已经有这么多这么多的这个源头啦，啊，就是源 acharyas。化身啊，这个源头是 Krishna。
So you're the absolute authority.
那 Krishna 你是绝对的权威。
So similarly here, Srila Prabhupada also names Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, Nimbarka, Vishnuswami.
所以在这里 Prabhupada 也讲出了像啊 Madhvacharya, Ramanujacharya, Nimbarka, Swami 啊这些人。
He also mentions Shankaracharya.
Prabhupada 也提到 Shankaracharya.
Who is representing an impersonal spirit.
他代表是非人格的。
With Shankaracharya, he also stated in several places.
因为 Shankaracharya 在很多地方也提到他的名字。
Narayana Parodhyakta.
Narayana Parodhyakta.
That Lord Narayana is the supreme beyond everyone.
就是主 Narayana 呢是至尊，他是超越所有生物的。
Devakinam Nandito.Gita Mahatmya is pointing out also, let there be one scripture Bhagavad Gita, let there be one, you know, supreme absolute Vasudeva, son of Devaki.
在这个《薄伽梵歌》的荣耀里面说 ，Krishna 是至尊人格首身，啊，他是绝对真理，是一切的源头。
Vajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandanvajrakulandan
所以呢，很多呢，就是像 Sankaracharya 的这些自己本身呢，就是很多导文在赞颂给他，像说 Bhajagovinda、Bhajagovinda 这些的。
So in essence, we understand he's a covered personalist.
所以这样子，我们可以了解他是就是说掩饰的，掩饰他原来身份的出现。
But he is having special task and mission to perform. This is why his teachings are not so open, so straightforward.
那就是 Sankaracharya 他有特别的任务出现，所以呢，他的教导就是说有一些东西没有那么直接讲出来。
So basically, when he points out.Krishna is the absolute authority.
那基本上也是 Sankaracharya 指出来，就是说 Krishna 是绝对真理。
So this is why we have to accept the right authority, not just any kind of authority. That's another point when we approach, when we try to learn something, we have to understand that something is orthodox.
这就是为什么我们要走向这个正确的权威啊，这是非常重要。
Because like Prabhupada said, cheaters and the cheated.
因为泡泡他说。有骗子的存在是有人想要被骗，所以骗子跟被骗者是同时存在。
Because if we want something cheap and we don't really want to surrender, then definitely there are so many wonderful opportunities for gaining something like this.
因为 Prabhupada 提到，就是说有人想要廉价的东西呢，不想要真正的东西呢，那就有很多很多骗子来骗啊。然后伪装成那是真的样子。
And therefore, of course, ultimately being disappointed because we didn't gain what we were supposed to.
当然啦、啊，这样子，用廉价的方式，然后去碰到骗子呢，那最终当然是失望，因为没有办法得到想要的。
Because in one sense, most often everybody wants to be absolute, as I said, an authority himself.
因为从一个角度来说呢，每一个人每一个 生物终想最终呢，它是绝对真理的权威。
So in the essence, we are cheating for ourselves.
In the essence,
we are cheating ourselves by having such kind of mentality.
所以呢，有这样的心态的精髓，或是它的原因呢，是因为我们自己想当主人，想当权威。
So Prabhupada here also is using the example. From the Nyaya Shastra.
包括的例子用的就从那个娘娘的经典，就是说逻辑上的经典。
To understand that the principle that let's say all the men are mortal, all the men are mortal.
比方说啦，所有的生物都是会死啊。
So that's a logical sequence. If you say all the men are mortal, and we say somebody else is the man, so therefore that man is also mortal.
所以他的逻辑概念就是说，所有的生物都是会死的。那所以只要说提到某一个，然后他这个结论就是这个也会死。
So that the interesting point in the logic is the logic itself is not an absolute evidence, it's not the absolute truth.
所以呢，他从逻辑的原则来看，他这种观点呢也是很合理，就是说不是绝对的。
And interestingly, Ramanujacharya, in one of his commentaries, he points out that you cannot prove God by logic.
那在这个 Ramanujacharya 的教导里面说呢，你不能用逻辑来证明神的存在。
So logic in itself is not complete.
所以逻辑本身也是不完整的。
Because even in the inductive method deductive method.
然后就是从那个所谓从上传下来的这个。
You still have the beginning part, which is very much dependent on information.
因为他那个从上，他们这种概念呢，就是说你最开始也是一定要有个源头，有个讯息才能传递出来。
All men are mortal. Okay, fine. All men are mortal, but how do we know this? So we have to receive the information.
那如果说所有的生物。都会死，或是说所有生物都是永长生不死，不管是哪个概念，你一定要有一个源头来这样子扩展它这个逻辑。
Because like you can understand, for example, that God exists because we see creation everywhere and somebody behind the creation. Yes.
比方说啦，我们说讲到神的存在呢，是因为我们看到所有的万物一直在存在，虽然有很多变化，太阳各种星球啦。在变化，但是是一直一直都存在。我们知道这个创造一定后面有一个人在做这个操作。
But not so conclusive argument because it doesn't tell us whether it's one person, many persons.
当然啦，就是说所有一切的发生后面一定有一个人在这边创造操作，但是还不够完整，就是说没有告诉我们是这个最源头是一个人还是很多人在架构操纵。所以在他这个范围，在这种逻辑跟这个推这个知识的范围，就是说没有讲到后面源头是男的他、女的他，还是一个人，还是很多人，然后他是什么样子，是谁都没有说到。
So therefore, again, information has to come from the altered source.
所以呢，就回过头来说，这个知识呢，一定要从一个权威、正统的源头。
So this is even in that kind of inductive, in deductive process. What to speak of inductive process, where you're trying to understand something by your own so-called reason.
这个已经是从上面传递下来的知识了啊，都已经还需要这个更正确的源头啊。那更何况是说我们从下面去推敲、去推演到上面的这种知识方法。
Absolutely imperfect, as earlier Srila Prabhupada mentions the four defects we mentioned in the book.
就好像包括在这个前面有说到生物的四个缺陷啊。
So we just have to accept an authority.
就是我们还是必须要接受权威。
So the question is which kind of authority?
那问题就是说是哪一类哪一个权威？
So this is by their advice, by Srila Prabhupada here, to approach the absolute, an absolute authority, which is Krishna.
所以这里就是Prabhupada所说的呢，这个权威，绝对的权威呢，就是 Krishna, 就是绝对真理。
like once, I think there was, there was a discussion between Prabhupada raised the question, he asked the devotees, you know, when you worship Krishna, you know, how do you know Krishna is Lord?
就像包括他曾经问过奉献者说，我们怎么在知道崇拜 Krishna？ 我们在崇拜 Krishna， 为什么要这么做？然后我们怎么知道谁是 Krishna？
So one devotee said, Prabhupada, because there are so many authorities, you know, so many authorities they say that, so many acharyas they say Krishna is Lord.
那个就有门徒回答包括他就说因为呢很多的权威很多的 acharya 都说到 Krishna 就是这个神
so many, because so many personalities with such a great character on them, they have testified that Krishna is God
因为有很多伟大的人物他们宣言他们证实呢 Krishna 是神
so then again so Prabhupada agreed and then again at some other place so Prabhupada raised the same question
所以包括他同意他们这么说但是呢到了后来的另外一个地方另外的时候包括同样问这个问题
and then the same devotee was present earlier in the conversation
那在这个场合里面之前出现的那个奉献者也在这个地方
they were just kind of thinking wow I know the answer to this question
所以那个奉献者就想说他知道答案然后他就要说了所以当婆婆问了他自己就要回答了
But Prabhupada said no
当然他回答同样的答案之后婆婆说不
And then he was shocked What to do now?
所以他就很震惊他说现在怎么办呢
And then Prabhupada explained Well yes we can accept it in a way But actually there is another reason There is something much more deeper
than that 那婆婆说是、可是呢、当然说这个是可以接受的但是还有另外的理由有比这个更深的理由
And then another devotee just answered No problem, just because from within the heart you just know, we understand Krishna is the Supreme
那另外一个奉献者回答说就是我们从心里就是知道 Krishna 就是至尊人格首身
Prabhupada confirmed, he said yes, this is also the answer
那 Prabhupada 也认同确定就是说这也是一个答案
Because you can have the personal experience that Krishna is the Supreme Person.
因为也可以有个人真正的直接经验，说 Krishna 是至尊人格首身。
So in this way, we can understand that Krishna is the absolute authority.
所以从这样子，我们可以去了解呢 ，Krishna 是至尊权威。
And accepting his teachings, therefore we can understand anything beyond our sense perception.
所以呢，接受 Krishna 的教导，我们就可以去了解所有超越啊，我们感官可以知道的这一些知识。
And therefore come to the right conclusion.
所以从这样子接受他的权威，我们会得到正确的结论。
Otherwise, you will be completely lost in that, like dog chases its tail, you know, kind of simple reasoning.
因为啊、就是有这样子正确的源头的话，我们就可以正确的知识跟结论。但是如果不是这样子的话，我们就像一条狗，自己看着尾巴追着自己的尾巴在那边转，一直在那边转着跑。
Because that's what happens when you know somebody doesn't want to surrender.
啊，那种这个自己追着自己尾巴这样子绕着跑的人，就是说那些不想臣服的人会变成是这样子。
Or again, if somebody surrenders, you know, very blindly.
或者是说那种盲目追从的人对什么都不了解
They cannot come to any right
那种人也没有办法得到任何正确的结论
okay, so I think we can read the next one
我们下一个
it's a big one I guess
page
上
page
上
Brahmasamhita is it the next paragraph
Yeah, like the first word, like this. So after Brahma Samhita, maybe.
Or about middle somewhere.
Ananta. Krishna Govinda has innumerable forms, like this, because the top.
Yeah. 这个在婆罗门罗赞 Brahma Samhita 中有个说明，就是。乘坐以星夜的速度飞驰的飞机，我们现有的飞机能以每个小时2000英里的速度飞翔。但什么是星夜的速度呢？比如说，你们坐在家里， 一旦想到一万英里之外的印度，印度就立刻浮现在你们心中，你们的心念已经去了那里，心念的速度就这么快。因此经典中说，如果你以这样的速度旅行几百万年，你就会发现灵性天空是无边无际，甚至连接近它都是不可能的。所以韦达训谛说，人必须找一个真正的灵性导师咕噜，这里用了必须这个强制性的词。那么灵性导师的资格是什么呢？他必须从正确的源头正确的聆听韦达信息，必须实际上稳固你处在泛的层面上。这个灵性导师必须有的两项品质，如果不是这样，他就不是真正的灵性导师。
So here also Srila Prabhupada is pointing out that sages and yogis, they cannot understand Krishna.
所以宽宽这里也指出了，就是说，瑜伽师啊，还有圣人呢、啊，他们也是没办法了解 Krishna。
How can somebody who is Anu, who is so limited, small, understand something that is enormously great, people, Krishna, Krishna's people that means it's just.
就是我们是这么渺小、安努有限的能力的生物，怎么有办法去了解无限的主离谱？
Krishna says the same thing in the beginning of 10th chapter. He said, "Vidu Devanandama." He said, "Nor demigods, nor sages, that they cannot understand."
所以 Krishna 在第十章里面说了，不管是半神人啊，或圣人啊，他们都没办法了解他。
Fantastico ti shatta sampramava.Sevamana, like Brahma Samhita says, this is the same verse basically, that you know, yogi can travel like millions and millions of miles by the speed of mind.
就像婆罗门果在里面说的，这个瑜伽师啊，他们心意训练到很快很快的速度，可以一小时，比方数千英里的速度到另外一个天空星际。
We can't even imagine that kind of speed.
我们是无法去想象那种心意的速度。
Mind is faster.Even than the speed of light.
我们心意的速度是比光速更快。
Because within my mind, I can be now in the.
In India,
I can be in
Africa
if I want.
In what?
By the speed of mind, I can be on the sound plan.
有些人如果都有一些兴趣有知识。
For sun, it takes 8 minutes for the one sun ray to come to the planet. It can be 8 minutes, but within my mind, I can be there instantly.
But that
sun
is not.
就是如果太阳要到地球的，只要当如果某一个太阳光子到地球只要八分钟的这个这么快的速度，但是我们心意的速度是比那个光速更快，因为我们对那个星球有知识的话，我们心意想到那里，可以马上到那个星球去了。
What is the speed of light? 182 miles.
Per minute. Per second.
Per second.
那光速是不是每一秒182英里？光速非常快，好像太阳啊，或什么宇宙光进来的话。
So, but in my mind, I can be anywhere. So just imagine, it is stated here that yogis, you know, within their mind is traveling by the speed of mind. They cannot reach Krishna for millions of years.
所以呢，就是说光速是这么快的，但是如果说有去练那个心意功的人呢，就是说他的心意可以很快很快进到任何星球去。但是呢，经典上说呢，即使这样子呢，这些瑜伽师他们还是千百万年在这样子心意的这样去游荡、漂游，还是没有办法找到至尊主，没有办法到灵性世界。
The idea is we cannot capture Krishna. We cannot, you know.
这个概念，这个意思就是说，我们没有办法去抓到 Krishna， 我们也不能控制 Krishna。
Like Damodar Lila or something.
就好像达摩达这个逍遥时光啊，他一直要抓着 Krishna 抓不到。
We can, you know, Krishna can reveal himself. Krishna can surrender himself, so to say, to the devotee by the love.
Krishna 可以把自己交给他的奉献者，可以受他奉献者的管束，是由于那个奉献者的爱，他会接受。
That by any mechanical process or just by our wishing it, that you know we can reach and capture.
那这个 Krishna 会接受的程序，不是说由于机械化的行为、机械化的态度，或者说我们认为我们的愿望想要这样的 ，Krishna 就会满足我们这样的愿望。
Because interestingly, also here in Isha Upanishad, later on there will be three two verses.
那在这个至尊奥义书后面的有三个诗节。
15, 4, 5, and 6 discussing about so-called contradictory nature, very amazing nature of Krishna.
那就是说第四、第五、第六节会讲到 Krishna让人觉得互相矛盾的他的本质哈 ，Krishna 有一些特性让人觉得他好像自相矛盾。
He's far, he's near.
啊，就是说 Krishna 是既远又近。
He walks, he doesn't walk.
Krishna 会走也不走。
You know, he runs faster than anybody.
那 Krishna 跑的话是比任何生物都跑得快。
So nobody can get.
所以没有人可以抓到 Krishna.
Of course, it's not that.Literally, Krishna has to run to hide or.
这个意思不是说 Krishna 要跑得很快去藏起来的意思。
He has all the powers. He is Yogeshwar.
Krishna 是 Yogeshwar， 就是说他是所有瑜伽师之主。
But in essence, anybody who is not qualified, he cannot come close.
但是这个要点就是说，如果一个没有资格人的话的人是没有办法接近 Krishna 的。
And some kind of material powers like cities.Which yogis might possess, or any mechanical means or technology, whatever it can never reach.
那同样的就是说，任何的物质的方法，或是任何的神通功力啦，任何这些物质的都没有办法去接近 Krishna.
What is the method of reaching Krishna?
要到 Krishna 或接近 Krishna 是什么方法
？Who knows?
谁知道？怎么样接近 Krishna?
What is how to?
所以就是说我们变得谦卑臣服于奉献者然后呢不可能说我们自己走向 Krishna 然后 Krishna 就会很亲近我们就是要从他的奉献者那一边 Krishna 感到这种亲爱
Tad Vijanartam Tad Eva Vigacha Krishna this is Mundaka Upanishad Krishna says no not to me directly you have to surrender to the Guru you have to accept the Guru
所以在蒙达卡奥义书里面 Krishna 说不的不行的你不可能直你不可以直接也没办法直接走向我这里必须要向咕噜臣服
This is the process.
是这样的程序才有办法
Tadvidi Pranipatina Parikrishna Sedan Parikshanti Tejanam Ganyasatvalashi
这是在佛学范格里面说你要走向灵性导师的这个方法
So yes, once we like you talk we were talking about the authority once we recognize and accept somebody as an authority but then we have to be qualified
所以呢，当我们认出了某一个人是真正的权威的时候，啊，我们要走向他呢，我们也要让自己有资格接近他们。
So we have to submissive attitude.
我们必须要有这种臣服的态度。
We have to inquire.
而且要谦虚的询问。
We have to be humble.
那谦虚的态度。
So then only in the Guru can impart knowledge.
所以当我们具备这些品质啊要谦虚臣服服务啊询问这样的态度呢咕噜才会把这知识揭示给我们。
There's nothing like, you know, you can steal the knowledge, like nowadays, you know,
copy
materialists try to do and scientists and so on, they will take the knowledge and then they'll benefit from this. There's nothing like this.
所以没有偷取知识的这种情况所以 Krishna 一定要我们有这种态度不像说现在的科学界啦或是存在里面啦就是说你去找什么方法去偷取他们的知识
I can steal some information and now I have the key to the essence of existence or this and that
不是说我找到方法去偷哪里的知识然后我就有这个钥匙这个过关密门啦可以到那个什么我要的地方或要的东西
Maybe You know, when the attitude is not appropriate, then that knowledge won't function, it won't work.
所以这个重点就是说，这个态度是关键。如果态度不正确的话呢，它给我们的这个知识也没办法展示的有作用，或是说没有办法完全恰当的进行。
Can anyone think of any example?
请问各位有没有想到例子来展述这样子的情况？
When you look at Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was in the big.
Okay.
He was really good.
Ah, that's a different thing. It's somebody who had received the information and knowledge, but actually didn't have a proper
attitude.
Positive point of view, then, fine. But from what we're discussing here in Mahabharata, there are several examples of karma and kalavya.
在这个摩诃波罗多伟大的巴拉达里面讲的 Ekalavya and
Karna
跟 Ekalavya 这两个人的例子。
Karna was lying that he was that he was Brahman.
Karna 是一个普通。
He presented himself as a Brahman because Parashuram wouldn't teach Kshatriya. He was allergic to that kind of blood.
Parashuram 呢，不愿意对 Karna 教授他知识，因为Parashuram 对这个 Karna 他们这种阶级这种人呢，好像敏感，就是说反感啊，所以不愿意去教他。
There's a whole story that blood that dripped, you know, from the thigh of Karna, and there's a worm that's digging into it that dripped on the head of Parashuram, and he woke up. What is this? You're tolerant. You know, it's possible. You don't check. You're not Brahmana. Brahmana can do whatever it is. Brahmana's tolerance is different. It's not doing it different. It's not like that.
因为呢，就是 Parashuram 正在躺着休息或怎么样的，那 Karna 正好有虫子去咬他腿啊，结果那个腿肉被咬了一口还怎么样，就流血，那个血流在滴在那个 Parashuram 的头上，那他就很不高兴，觉得很反感，就是说你呀、啊，你一定不是婆罗门，婆罗门的人呢可以忍受你。一切，那下一只虫子咬你呀、啊，你就让它这样子，你去抓它，然后抓着流血又流在我头上，所以呢，你不属于婆罗门这样的人呢，我不愿意教你。
So, Parashurama, we know 21 times he just went around the world and killed all the kshatriyas. 21 times. He killed all the kshatriyas. He gave the what? That's the whole story.
那 Parashurama 呢，他就。绕遍整个宇宙21次，杀了所有的沙俱尔阶层的人，就是、说杀了很多很多的士兵哈。
And then he definitely wouldn't he gave a wow. He would have never taught the kshatriya. He would have never given this knowledge. Because he was allergic to kshatriyas in that sense. That's an expression. He just becauseThey were not following the principles. They were not righteous. Mostly that time.
所以呢 ，Parashuram 就发誓，他以后都不去对那些 Kshatriya 啊这些武士的人去传授知识，因为他认为这当时他的状态，面对那些武士、这些 Kshatriya 这些人呢，都不守规矩，不守他们的职责，所以他对他们反感，所以以后碰到这种人，他都不去教传授知识。
So anyway, Karna received the knowledge of celestial weapons, but then Parashuram cursed him, said at the time when you need them the most, you'll actually, you won't be able to remember the mantras you use them. So he cursed him. So there's no use of cheating and gaining knowledge.
那 Karna 呢？他先前用不正当方法去所谓。获取这个知识，所以他呢，虽然有这个他这个 Parashuram 的这一些武术的知识，然后怎么杀敌什么的，可是呢 ，Parashuram 因为不接受他心理上的，就是说你即使有这个知识，可是他诅咒 Karna， 就是说如果 Karna 以后要用到这个知识的时候，用到要出招的时候呢，他就会忘记这个 mantra， 他就用不了。虽然他平时可能有。知道，可是真正要用的时候呢，已经被诅咒，他不记得那个 mantra， 用不出来了。
Ekalavya also, he was rejected by Dronacharya. He wasn't qualified, didn't have a proper character.
Ekalavya 也是一样，他是得到这个 Dronacharya 的知识，但是他没有资格，而且他态度不对。
But then still, mechanically, he tried to imbibe himself with the qualities, you know, of Drona by worshipping, making him.Deity of Drona and worshipping in such a way and absorb the qualities of Drona.
那这个 卡拉比亚呢，他就是用一些方法想要获得这个 Dronacharya 的这个知识呢，所以他就做了这个 Dronacharya 的雕像，然后对他崇拜，那希望在崇拜中呢得到这 Dronacharya 的品质。
And he did became even greater archer than Arjuna.
所以呢，卡拉比亚他就做这个 Dronacharya 崇拜他，那后来他这个。Eklavya 的力量就很强大，然后胜过阿朱呢。
So it's not the skills, it's the mentality, it's the attitude.、
所以呢，重点不是说一个人得到多少技巧、技能，而重点是这个态度，他的心态是什么呀
？So ultimately, neither Drona, neither Krishna were happy about Eklavya. Later on, therefore, Krishna even killed him.
那这个情况就后来那个。Dronacharya 不帮这个 Eklavya， Krishna 也不帮他，甚至 Dronacharya 把 Eklavya 杀掉。
So just some examples to point out that we have to have a proper attitude once we approach it.
所以这个就是重新再强调，就是当我们走向前门的时候，我们必须要有正确的心态态度。
And then as we know, yesterday we put our bhakti to today, yesterday we put our guru. Basically, when we have implicit faith within the authority within the guru.Sadhu Shastra, then all the knowledge will be revealed unto us.
所以这个就是说，如果我们对 Guru 经典还有 Krishna 至尊主啊，这有全然的坚毅不摇的信心的时候，所有的知识才会，我们得到知识才会展示出来。
So this is why we have to approach a bona fide Guru, and Prabhupada explains here who that Guru is, that he must also have received the knowledge from you.
所以帕巴就在这里指出了，就为什么我们必须要、走向一个正宗的权威人士，就是一个正宗的咕噜。那帕巴就说，这个正宗的咕噜是我们的权威。
Okay, so we can read. Hopefully, we can complete the introduction today.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So
Krishna Govinda has innumerable forms, but they're all one. So he's talking about the forms.
It was about Guru. Yeah, the next.
In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says the actual aim of Vedic research is to find out Krishna.
Yes. Yes.
在第七页的啊、
第
差不多三分之二啊，这场 Krishna 意识运动完全得到 Veda 原则的认可。伯杰梵歌中记载 ，Krishna 说，研习 Veda 经的真正目的是要找到 Krishna。在 Brahma Samhita 婆罗恨魔战中也说明。Krishna Govinda 虽然有数不胜数的形象，但都是一个。他那些形象不同于我们的形象啊。我们的这边应该是形体，因为这英文是 form 啊。我们的形体是有缺陷的，不完美的。而他的形体绝对完美无瑕。我的形体有开始存在的时候，但他各种无数的形体无始无终，永恒存在 ，Ananta。我的形体坐在这里时，就不在我的公寓里；你们坐在这里时，就不在你们的公寓中。但 Krishna 可以同时在所有的地方，他可以在 Goloka Vrindavan 那里坐下来，同时又无所不在，在所有的地方。他是最初存在的第一个人，最古老。但你们无论何时看到 Krishna 的照片，都看到一个十五或二十岁的青少年形体。你们永远都找不到他的老人形体。你们已经看过了伯杰梵歌上的 Krishna 驾驭马车的形体，他那时已经有一百多岁了。他有曾孙子，但看上去就像个青少年。Krishna 神永远都不变老，那是他的至尊力量。你们若想透过研究韦达文献调查清楚 Krishna， 就会感到挫折。那也许有可能，但极其困难。但你们透过他的奉献者，就可以很容易认识他。他的奉献者可以将他送到你们面前，说：“这就是他，接受他吧。”这是 Krishna 的奉献者的力量。
So the essence is that Krishna has so many innumerable forms.
这个情况要点就是说 ，Krishna 有无数的形体。
Srimad Bhagavatam explains that they're like waves in the ocean.
在《伯伽瓦坛》里面说到 ，Krishna 的形体呢，多的不可数，无数的形体，就像波海洋的波是无数的。
He can be here, and simultaneously he's in the spiritual world, and he's everywhere simultaneously.、
所以 Krishna 呢，可以此刻就在这里，但同时也是在灵性世界，同时也在所有的星球存在里。
Prabhupada points out, even though on Kurukshetra battlefield he was 125 years old, but he looked like a 16 years old boy.
Prabhupada 也说了 ，Krishna 呢在库卢之野的时候 ，Krishna 已经是125岁了，但是 Krishna 看起来还是16岁的这种青年的这样。
Because he's always Navayomana.
因为 Krishna 是 Navayomana， 就是说他是永远青春。
So the point here, what Prabhupada is saying, is that we cannot understand Krishna, we cannot, you know, realize who Krishna actually is ourselves.
所以 Prabhupada 在这里说呢，我们自己是无法了解 Krishna， 我们无法真正认识 Krishna。
You know, we want to find Krishna, we don't even know who Krishna is. How can we find him?
就我们自己能力是没办法，就像我们想知道 Krishna， 我们怎么知道谁是 Krishna， 然后去哪里找他？那我们从哪里可以知道神呢？有这种概念从哪里来？
You know, what to speak of, even let's say we know, somehow we find that out, but how do we know how to relate to him? How do we know how to serve him? We have no idea.
好，即使不管什么原因，我们有一点。我们有讯息知道说有 Krishna 有神存在，但是我们、又要去哪里找到他呢？用什么方法去找他？
This is why we have to be trained. This is why we have to qualify.
这就必须为什么我们要受到训练，我们必须要有资格。
You know, let's say, I know someone, and some of my friends, let's say, come and want to have a relationship with that person.
比方说有一个人呢、来了，那或者有人说到另外一个人，我朋友说了某一个人，我想要跟那个人有关系，要建立关系。
And such a new coming person will try to relate to the person I know, but they have no idea how to relate and what to do, how to serve, how to offer anything.
那个朋友说到那个人他过来了，但是他一定要透过他的朋友才会知道说怎么样跟这个当地的人事物、相关联。
So the idea is that that person has no idea how to please that, let's say, friend of mine, that other friend of mine.
所以这个意思就是说，对于朋友说到那个人呢，如果没有透过这个人的话，我没有。没有办法知道要怎么样去取悦那个人，怎么样去跟他相关联。
They may speculate, maybe he likes this, maybe we should do things like that, maybe.
所以就如果不是这样的情况呢，就是说要去推敲那个人他喜欢什么，他要怎么样，可能，就算很多都是只是推敲，可能猜测。
Or let's say, well, when the wife, you know, newlywed wife comes to some family or something.Tries to do certain things for the parents of her husband or something. She may try to be really, maybe she might have proper attitude and everything, but still she won't know how to do things. She has to be trained.
所以呢，就好像一个新婚妻子哈，一个新的媳妇到了丈夫家，开始要做这里家事，要怎么样来服务公公婆婆啊？也许她有这个好的态度，可是呢？他也是要有这个知识，还有方法，要知道怎么样去服务他的公公婆婆，取悦他的公公婆婆。
So、similarly, we have to be trained. We have to know what Krishna wants, how Krishna likes things to be done, and this and that, and so on.
所以，同样的，我们也是要得到训练。我们要知道，就是说 Krishna 是什么样子 ，Krishna 喜欢什么，然后我们要怎么样去做这样的训练。
And of course, we also have to qualify to be able to do anything.
当然，我们必须要有资格去得到这个训练。
So this is why, for both reasons, first to qualify to understand what Krishna likes and how to serve him, and then second of all, or primarily to understand who Krishna is himself, we need a guru, we need a guide.
所以呢，这就是这个两个要点，就是说呢，我们必须要有 one is guru and
we need a guide, somebody who is going to.
Yeah. And before that point, is we need.
To understand first who is Krishna, how to serve him, also all of this.
所以就是说，首先要有这个知识，要知道谁是 Krishna， 而且要怎么去服务他， 再来呢，我们需要有一个训练，就是我们要有一个咕噜啊，就是我们要有这个资格得到训练。
So all of that we can easily learn, so Prabhupada says, from a devotee. 嗯，
那这一切都可以很容易学到，包括他就是说来从奉献者那儿去学到的。
So this is why we have to approach. That's another reason why we have to approach devotee position. We cannot go directly.
这也是另外一个理由，就是说我们要先走向 Krishna 的奉献者啊，而不是说 Krishna， 不是我们没办法直接过到他那儿去。Veda 经原本只有一部，这是完整的一部，而且根本没有必要阅读它。古人是那么有智慧，而且记忆超群，仅仅聆听灵性导师说了一遍就理解了，他们可以立刻领会全部的主旨。然而五千年前 ，Vyasadeva 为了这个卡里年代的人着想，将 Veda 经写了下来。他知道人们最终都变得寿命很短，记忆力很差，而且不再有敏锐的智慧。他想，因此让我透过着来教授这 Veda 知识吧。他将一部 Veda 经的分成了四部 ：Rig Veda、Summer Veda、Atharva Veda、Yajur Veda， 然后让他们的几个门徒分别负责去保管、传播这些 Veda 经。接着，他又考虑到女士 ，stream 还有劳动者啊 ，sudra， 还有所谓再生者的朋友 ，divya bandhu 这一类人的利益。出生在 brahmana 婆罗门家中，但没有婆罗门品质的人，就被称为是再生者的朋友。这些人的智慧就更加逊色了。他为这一类人编纂了被称为古印度历史的《Mahabharata》《摩诃婆罗多》，还有十八部往事书《Purana》。这个往事书还有《Mahabharata》，还有四部韦陀经，还有《奥义书》，都是韦达文献的一部分。《奥义书》是韦达经的一部分。最后 ，Vyasadeva 为学者和哲学家总结了所有的韦达知识，写成的《Vedanta Sutra》，就是《终极韦陀经》。这是维达经的结论性的知识。Vyasadeva 虽然在他的灵性导师 Narada 的指导下亲自写下维达达经，但还是感到不满意。那是个很长的故事。圣典伯切瓦坛，也就是《伯切梵往事书》中记载说， Vyasadeva 即使在编纂了许多往事书和妙义书，甚至是维达达经后，还是很不满意。那时他的灵性导师 Narada 教导他说，你要了解终极韦陀经 Vedanta Sutra。 梵文将这个 Vedanta 的意思就是说最终极的知识，而最终极的知识是 Krishna。 Krishna 说全部 Veda 经的目的是为了了解他。 Vedanta Krit Vedanta Viva Chaham OK Krishna 说我是 Veda 经的编纂者和知识者，因此最高的目标是 Krishna。 所有的 Vaishnava 评论家在评论 Vedanta 哲学时都解释了这一点。我们 Gaudiya 传承的 Vaishnava 也有
okay,
so far yes
so that we have one last paragraph
okay.
So the idea here is what Prabhupada says that Vedic knowledge has been given there for as a guidelines for the humanity.
包括在这边解释说，伟达的经典呢，提供了给人类这个生活的指导。
And earlier it has been transmitted by the oral reception, just by definitely hearing.
过去的知识传授就是耳传心授啊，就是从聆听就可以将来传授知识，得到知识。
But because the Vedic knowledge is so complex, then Vyasadeva divided the Veda one into four different.
那因为韦达知识是非常广阔无边，又是非常复杂，所以这个 Vyasadeva 就把它分成四个部分，四部韦陀。
Because Rig basically essentially means hymns,
Rig Veda 基本上讲的是有韵律的这一些东西，诗词韵律。
Refers to different ritual processes of rituals.
Yajur Veda 讲的基本上是各种仪式、祭祀、牺牲的这些仪式。
Like more technical, like that presented, and then Yajur basically are, or Sama. Sama means prayers.
那 Sama Veda 基本上讲的是指啊祈祷文、祈祷赞颂。
You know, once the deity is invoked, manifested, then the prayers, and then Atharva it was everything else that was left.
那就是说，阿塔就是第四部委托的内容，就基本上就是说前面三部的内容之外，所有的知识就在这个阿塔这个委托这一部分了。
And then because people in Kali Yuga are so unqualified, then Vyasadeva also presented Itihasa as like one part.
那由于呢，在卡利年代的演进，人们的各种能力都减低减弱了，没有办法去了解，所以 Vyasadeva 呢又呈现了这个 Itihasa 这一类的像史诗故事性的叫做 Itihasa， 像伟大的婆罗多这一些经这些故事来讲述。
And the Purana so that people through the stories, which embody the Vedic teachings, can learn and be attracted to its spirituality.
然后呢，同时也就是说，他编纂了这些不同的往事书，就是说故事性质的时候，然后这个故事性质是从韦陀经典的精华讲述出来的故事，让人们可以从这种聆听故事中得到这个经典。
But even then, Prabhupada points out that Vyasadeva was not satisfied, therefore Narada Muni instructed him to directly glorify Krishna and talk about Krishna.
那婆罗巴也指出了，这个 Vyasadeva 虽然写了那么多，把这韦陀经都写述出来了，他自己本身还是不满足。后来呢，遇到 Narada Muni 呢， Narada Muni 跟他指示，就是说应该把直接对至尊人格守神讲述出来，这样子 Vyasadeva 才有办法感到满足。
And this is what the essence is, Vedanta Vibhaga Krit Eva Chaham。
这个意思就是说，这个刚刚讲的这个伟丹塔终极委托的目的，就是要了解至尊主。
Krishna is the essence of the Vedic knowledge.
Krishna 呢是委托经典的精髓。
And again, as you said, Krishna is the absolute authority. You should directly approach Krishna. There's no, we don't have much time here in this Kali Yuga also.
那再来就是说 ，Krishna 是至尊绝对真理、至尊权威，所以我们必须要这样去走向，因为我们。寿命不长了，没有那么多时间浪费在很多枝节的事，所以要直接走到 Krishna 这一条途径。
Directly approach a bona fide spiritual master who can lead us.
所以我们就必须要走向一个正统的灵性导师，那个灵性导师是可以带领我们的走到 Krishna 的这样的人。
Okay, so let's complete the introduction.
然后就把这个上面继续。我们 Gaudiya Vaishnava 纯粹对Vedanta 哲学的注释，就是由 Baladeva Vidyabhushana 所写下来的 Govinda Bhasha。同样的呢 ，Ramanujacharya 和 Madhvacharya 都各自留下他们的评注，所以 Shankaracharya 的作品并不是唯一的评注。对于 Vedanta 经啊，终极韦陀经的评注注解有很多，但由于 Vaishnava 并没有最先将 Vedanta 经的评注呈现给世人，人们就留下了 Shankaracharya 对 Vedanta 经的评注是唯一的，这是一个错误的印象。除此之外 ，Vyasa 本人也写下对 Vedanta 经完美的注解，就像圣典波切瓦谈哈。圣典波切瓦谈是以《维达达经》的第一句话 “Jamadi Asayata” 为开端的第一篇第一章的第一节诗中所说，并在诗其中给予了全面透彻的解释。终极韦陀经对于绝对真理 （Brahman） 只是大概的说，绝对真理是出发一切的那一位，只不过是一个概述。而圣典波切瓦谈。圣典波切瓦谈中给予了详细的解释，如果一切都由绝对真理发出，那么绝对真理的本质是什么呢？圣典波切瓦谈对此给予了解释，绝对真理必然有意识，它是自明的 Svara， 我们通过从他人那里接受知识，去发展，去培养我们的意识和知识。但经典中说，主他是自明的。维丹达经、终极韦陀经是全部维达经知识的总结。而在终极韦陀经，就是维丹塔这个作者在他的编纂的圣典薄伽瓦坛中对了维达经的解释啊。我们最后请求真正在追求维达知识的人们，努力从圣典薄伽瓦坛和薄伽梵歌中了解对所有维达知识的解释吧。
So it is interesting how Srila Prabhupada is completing this and concluding the introduction to Shish Upanishad.
所以很有意思，就是说 Prabhupada 就把这个怎么样来对至尊奥义书来结论。
He's inviting everybody to study Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam。
Prabhupada 在邀请所有的人来研读圣典薄伽瓦坛，还薄伽梵歌。
He points out how Bhagavad Gita Bhushan presented a commentary to the Dhamma Sutra。
那 Prabhupada 提出的。巴拉德维德布什的这个对这个维达经的注解。
In this way, establishing the authority of Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya.
所以婆婆也引用了巴拉德维德布什的注解来就是说提出了这个是建立 Gaudiya Vaishnava 传承的哲学的体系。
Which in essence, Gaudiya Vaishnava didn't consider that it has to be done in any way because which Gaudiya Vaishnava didn't consider it was necessary to.Present a commentary on the Dhamma Sutra. Yeah, they didn't consider it necessary.
在 Gaudiya Vaishnava 传承里面，对于说呈现这个《终极韦陀经》这个《终极韦陀经》这部经呢，也没有必要去把它拿出来。
Because Vyasadeva himself wrote the commentary on the Dhamma Sutra, which is Srimad Bhagavatam.
因为 Vyasadeva 本人他讲述的这个。终极韦陀经的注解，也就是我们知道的这个圣典薄伽瓦坛，就是终极韦陀经的精华跟注解。
Has been instructed by his guru Narada Muni when he was despondent.
因为 Vyasadeva 去讲述啊，这个薄伽瓦坛就是终极韦陀经的精华呢，是得到他灵性导师的训示 ，Narada 这样子的指导而去做的。
So you all know the story of how the devotion how he wrote the commentary Govinda Bhajan.
就是大家知道这个巴拉德维德布什呢，他是怎么样去写就 Govinda Bhasha 这个经典的这个典故吗？一般不知道。
Well, in Jaipur, where the deity of Govinda Ji is, that is in Rajasthan states.
在帝都这个粉红城，加尔普这个Govinda， 这个加尔普这个粉红城这个城市的 Govinda 庙里面。
So the worship has been done there by Ramananda group of Vaishnavas, which come in the line of Ramanujacharya.
Ah, 那这个Jaipur 的Govinda 庙的这个崇拜呢，是由 Ramanujacharya 的这些跟随者，还有他的后代呢，去崇拜这个 Govinda Ji.
So they challenged the king that Krishna cannot be worshipped in Dadarani. Dadarani should be set aside.
所以他们就跟那个 Jaipur Rajasthan 的国王挑战，然后他们就说：“哦 ，Krishna 只能单独崇拜，不能让 Radha Rani 跟他一起崇拜 ，Radha Rani 必须是分开来崇拜。”
But there is no reference to Radha Rani and Krishna worship in the Shastra.
但是当时没有经典提到说 Radha 跟 Krishna 崇拜的这些事情。
Of course, Radha Rani, you know, is mentioned in several Puranas and so on. Anyway, Gaudiyas basically they accept worship and it has been essentially introduced by Madhavendra Puri.
那在很多的 Gaudiya 传承里面，当然我们都很熟悉啊，很多地方都有讲到 Radha Rani. 那所以他们也接受呢。
So now the king, you know, what to do? He was like so puzzled. Why? How can it has been worshipped now for so many years since the deities came from Vrindavan?
所以当时这个国王就被这么问，他就当时很困惑，怎么办？因为这 Radha Govinda 呢，从 Vrindavan 来到这个 Jaipur 了，已经崇拜这么久，而且大家都一直在崇拜。
And I have departed Radharani now, Krishna has to be worshipped alone, and now how is it possible?
所以他就想说。那现在怎么办呢？这个 Radha 跟 Krishna 已经被人们崇拜这么久，现在我要让他们分开呢，这个怎么处理？怎么办呢
？And yeah, yeah, and those Gaudiya Vaishnavas who were doing worship there at that time, they couldn't respond to the challenge of the Ramanandis.
那这个当时的 Gaudiya Vaishnavas Vaishnava 在那边崇拜 Radha Govinda 的时候，他们就不知道怎么去回应这个 Ramanuja 的后代的这些言论，或是要辩论。
So at that time in Vrindavan, there was a very, very famous acharya, it was Vishwanatha Chakravarti.
那时候在 Vrindavan 有一个很有名的学者，就是
Vishwanatha
Chakravarti， 他过名字有点长，他在 Vrindavan。
So then he was requested to defend the Gaudiya Vaishnava teaching.
所以大家就要求他来跟这个这一派的人呢，来把这个言论把它。以前学者喜欢辩论嘛，所以请他出来来对他们来说。
But because he was too old at the time, so then he pointed out Baldev Devotion was his disciples to go and write the to meet the challenge.
啊，所以呢，Vishwanatha Chakravarti 他过当时年纪很大了，所以他就没办法，所以他就训斥他的门徒 Baldev Devotion 出场啊，然后对来对应这些人的言论。
And he was very, very scholarly, originally coming from the Madhva Sampradaya.
啊，那个巴拉德维德布什呢，是一个学者，很有学问，因为他从原来是从
Madhva Sampradaya.
他原来是从 Madhva Sampradaya 这个传承去学习的。
And Prabhupada also dedicates his commentary of Bhagavad Gita to Bala Devi Debhushan.
那 Prabhupada 对于他自己的注解说，他是根据 Bala Devi Debhushan 的讲述注解来做描述、做解释。
He also wrote many commentaries on other Upanishads and Bhagavad Gita itself.
Bala Devi Debhushan. 那当然了 ，Bala Devi Debhushan 呢，他也是一个很知识很丰富、很高的学者，他同时也写了很多其他经典的描述跟注解。
So then he came to Jaipur, and then the Ramanandis challenged that, you know, what is this worship of Radha Rani? And where are you, Gaudiyas? You don't even, you're not even a Sampradaya.
那这个时候呢 ，Bala Devi Debhushan 就到了 Jaipur， 然后去面对这 Ramanandi 这些人呢，那他们那些人挑战说，你们啊，你们从哪里有根据说去崇拜 Radha Krishna 一起崇拜？然后你们呢，算什么？你们也不属于什么传承的人，你们这样搞是搞什么
？Because they said every sampradaya, you know, if you want to establish a sampradaya, you have to have a commentary in Vedanta Sutra.
因为他们的立足点认为是说，在每个传承呢，一定要他们有自己的经典，是在对这个韦达经的注解的经典。
So then, what to do?
所以这个巴拉德他就想说怎么办？
Bhagavatam is natural commentary by Vyasa that Gaudiya is accepted.
因为我们Gaudiya传承的人是自然接受 Vyasa Dev 所写的这个圣典薄伽瓦坛，就是这个韦达经的这个注解精华。
So the king was very anxious, and everybody from the Gaudiya side was very anxious. What will happen now? How to defend? How to keep Radha Rani?
因为那个 Ramananda 这派人呢，就一直在这样去询问挑战。那这个国王啦，还有贾普那些人呢，很多这些Gaudiya Vaishnava 的奉献者就很着急啊，说现在怎么办了
？So then the Ramanandis were living in one place. That place is known as Galta. It's a little bit in the mountains, little hills above the Jaipur. It's not far. It's just few kilometers, a little bit, like 5-10 kilometers away from Jaipur. If you go around, but actually straight from Jaipur, it's maybe you know 2-3-4, very 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 close.
那当时这些 Ramanandi 这一些人，他们也是住在加古的城边呢，一个高铁这个地方，大概5-10公里的范围，很近，离这个市中心很近。
That is a place where some sages have performed the austerities earlier, and there's a natural spring that comes. It's in its Ganga, and beautiful pond is there, and beautiful architecture, palace and things. It's like very amazing place.
那个地方呢，就是说很多圣人曾经在那边修行做苦修，而且那个地方是一个小山的地方，然后还有泉水流出来，所以很多人在那边修行。
So there, anyway, Bala Devi Debhushan performed austerities, and he was fasting, he was praying to Govinda. This inspired to write, to do something, to present something to defend Gaudiya Vaishnava teaching.
那Bala Devi Debhushan呢，也在那个地方做苦行去修，然后去祈祷。他向那个Govinda 这个神像 Govinda Dev 就是跟他祈祷说。 主啊，请求求你给我力量，给我支持，让我做一点什么。他们在这样说呢，我要怎么办呢？请你让我知道应该怎么样来处理。
So then the deity himself, Govindaji, manifested in front of Baladeva with devotion, and he dictated to him within a short period of time the whole Govinda Bhajan.
然后因为这个巴拉德维达布什这么真诚的祈祷呢，那 Govinda Krishna Govinda 直接出现在巴拉德维达布什的面前，然后直接说出那个 Govinda Bhasha 这整个诗这个经典，直接对他这样。
Bhasha means commentary, and Govinda, therefore, Bhasha Devi Bhushan entitled him Govinda because Govinda himself was dictating him what to write.
所以 Govinda Bhasha Bhasha 的意思就是评注，那 Govinda 就是这个主 Govinda 自己本人，所以呢是 Govinda 自己所注解所评注的这一些东西。
And he presented that, and everybody was puzzled. Everybody was just, then they couldn't believe it. How is it possible within such a short period of time?Commentary has been presented, and they just didn't have any answer.
所以呢，大家都非常的困惑，就是说这么短的时间呢，对 Govinda 的注解就呈现出来，而且他们很难相信，就是主 Govinda 自己出来讲的，然后让巴拉德维达布什呢去这样子去把它写下来，他们想时间这么短，怎么可能呢？而且怎么可能他自己出来
？So Ramananda is really defeated, and King was very happy that.Radharani stayed together with Krishna.
当然，虽然呢，时间这么短，就 Govinda 自己的注解出现了。虽然这个 Ramananda 这一些人没办法，但是还得接受这样的权威，所以就是说在哲学论点上他们输了。所以呢，这个国王非常高兴，他们大家也非常高兴，可以继续崇拜 Radharani 跟 Govinda 聚在一起，这样一起崇拜。
So therefore, in this end of, introduction of this Ishopanishad, Prabhupada points out that yes, Ishopanishad is valid and important scripture, but to know more and to advance more, we have to also get information and practice something that is given in Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavatam.
当然呢，Prabhupada说呢，从伟达经呢这些东西也是非常多的知识，非常的足够。那Prabhupada这样的结论就是说，但是我们对于这个要走向 Krishna， 走到至尊绝对真理呢，我们需要知道的更多，了解的更多，就要从婆伽梵歌还有圣典婆伽瓦坛里面这样去得到去走。
Okay, so because time is quite low.
嗯，因为时间的情况，先讲到这。
So we will stop here.Any questions?
请问各位有没有任何问题或任何？
I don't remember. I guess within a week.
He closed himself in the altar.
Yes.
He closed himself in the altar.
In the altar. He was there in that place, Galta. Was it Galta or something? He was in Galta. He was in that place.Govindaji temple is within the city. So Govindaji personally came, he was there.
Just Baba Devi Vidyabhushan.
Maybe 3 days were there. Maybe 3 days or so. Or 1 day, I'm not sure.
就是问说那个 Govinda Bhushan, Govinda 评注这个书呢多久完成？那不是说他不确定是三天还一星期。
Whatever it is, you know, it's like, you know, to write a commentary, you would have need, you know, months or 70 years, maybe, or, you know, it's like, it's not such an easy task, but they demanded immediately, he said, otherwise, they were so forced.
就是说呢，因为一个书籍或经典的呈现，而且是在不管是在它的内容，或是道理，或是逻辑，要完全完美，天衣无缝呢。需要很久的时间，一般学者要很多个月才有办法把它弄出来。但是呢，这只有几天的时间呢，所以就像那个巴拉德维达布什呢，他在那个 Gaudiya 这个地方呢，那就 Govinda 呢自己本人出现在他面前，在那个地方呢，几天呢就让他这样写完了。所以这个意思就是说，你是非常超然的。
And just to mention, Govinda Bhasha, Krishna himself gives something, that kind of work is just incredible. That they couldn't, you know, they couldn't find any fault with it.
So,
it's amazing. What a wonderful commentary.
So, 就想想呢，这个 Govinda Bhasha 这个对 Govinda 的结论，对他的评注解呢，是 Krishna， 也就是 Krishna 自己本人讲出来，那是多么的惊人，多么的内容是完美无瑕的，是真的是非常非常的超然。
And King also really is a serious, that's it, finish. Discussion's over, Radharani says, that's it.
所以呢，当那个 Govinda 的评注这个出来之后，大家看了觉得真的哑口无言了，就是说，对 Krishna 就是跟 Radharani 站在一起崇拜的。被崇拜的，所以就不会把拉拉拉你跟 Krishna 分开。
Because also that people were not knowing that Radha Krishna is worshipable more highly than Lakshmi Narayan. Because previously Lakshmi Narayan was more worshipable.
Yeah.
Then after because of this community only they accepted that it is Radha Krishna is more higher than worship.
Whether it's higher or not, I don't know. Whatever it is, even we worship Radha and Krishna as Lakshmi Narayana.
Yeah.
But so whether it's higher or not, I don't know whether that was the question.
他问到就是说，先前呢，在对 Radha Krishna 崇拜之前，人们会认为对 Lakshmi 跟 Narayana 崇拜是最高的。但是现在 Radha 跟 Krishna 的崇拜被介绍出来，就公开的宣。公开的认证的样的，就是说 Radha 跟 Krishna 崇拜 是最高的，那是不是有表示在所谓谁高 谁高谁低的意味？但这个回答呢，朋友回答是说谁高？你说 Lakshmi Narayan 还是说Radha Krishna 谁比较高？这个我们他不敢说，因为呢，我们在虽然在崇拜 Radha Krishna， 但是我们是以崇拜。Lakshmi Narayan 这样心态是敬畏，我们在崇拜他们是以尊敬敬畏之心在崇拜，所以我们 很不敢 说谁高谁低。
Any other question? Okay. It's already 8:30. We can extend it, but there is no end to it. Okay. Shabbat shalom.